Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back to the first. Bismillah walhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. So inshallah ta'ala, I have some good news and some bad news before I continue. The bad news I'll start off with first is that inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to be taking a break inshallah ta'ala for the next month from this series, and we will resume bi'idhnillahi ta'ala in the first week of February inshallah. The good news is that inshallah ta'ala, from February until Ramadan, we should complete 40 episodes total with the first bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, and inshallah ta'ala will pick up afterwards. And the good news as well, it's more good news than bad news, is that inshallah ta'ala, throughout the month of January, we'll be working on our Ramadan series, as well as another series that is very relevant to things that are happening right now, inshallah ta'ala. So we'll be preparing other content of benefit bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, which we'll fill you all in on, inshallah, and give you a chance to catch up on what you've missed from the first, and then pick up in a few weeks bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, so that we can move forward. So jazakumullah khairan for tuning in for all of these weeks, and I hope this gives you a chance to review the notes, inshallah, and to catch up for those of you that have not been able to watch all of the previous episodes. Alhamdulillah. So here we are now, and inshallah what we're going to do is complete the story of Habiba radiallahu ta'ala anha. And just like we did with Salama radiallahu ta'ala anha, where we stopped at that juncture, right? That critical point where she has now, you know, really gone through this major transition where she's going to be in the companionship of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And there's a unique element to her being a wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. In the case of Habiba radiallahu ta'ala anha, before I even get into the next part of her story, I want us to actually just take a moment to think about how incredible this woman's istiqama, her commitment to faith actually is, right? First of all, she became Muslim and she faced what she faced from Abu Sufyan and her family in Mecca for becoming Muslim. And then she stays firm upon Islam when she's called to migrate. She could have held back in Mecca and told Ubaidullah ibn Jahsh, you go, I'll stay here in Mecca because I would likely not be persecuted because of my position with Abu Sufyan. But she stayed firm with her faith through the migration to Abyssinia. She stays firm upon her Islam despite her husband passing away and reportedly even leaving Islam, going through the apostasy and the death of her husband, Ubaidullah ibn Jahsh. She stays firm upon Islam despite her father, you know, assuming the role of being the chief antagonist against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his community. And she stays firm through all of these years, you know, just her and her daughter in Abyssinia, going through the hardships of being in a community in exile. So subhanAllah, I mean, when you think about istiqama, when you think about the strength of faith that was necessary uniquely to Salama radiallahu anha with the types of trials that she faced, and uniquely to Habiba radiallahu ta'ala anha, where there were multiple opportunities for her to walk away from her faith, but she did not. In fact, she only became stronger in her faith. And there's a reason why Allah chose to honor her with what he honored her with, and being a wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is not a blessing that Allah confers upon anyone. This is a very special blessing that was conferred upon her, and it is very clear that this is a special woman in regards to her faith and her commitment to that faith. So we said now that she has completed the wedding to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but you talk about a long, you know, Ketib Kitab phase, right? The contract has been written, everything has been done, but for 6 years, she's not going to be with her husband. And in the process, her daughter, Habiba, is growing up before her eyes, and it's just her and her daughter, and the special relationship that she has developed with Abraha. May Allah be pleased with them all. Finally, the time comes where the delegation of the people of the two hijras is now making its way to make that hijra to Medina, that migration to Medina. And Ja'far radiallahu ta'ala anhu leads a delegation of 16 families from Abyssinia to Medina, directly to Medina. And this is 7 years after hijra with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, after the Treaty of Hudaybiyah. And so there is safety for them to be able to make way without being persecuted, without being caught along the way and treated in any different way. So there's the joy that all of them have of being able to join the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but there's the unique joy that Habiba radiallahu ta'ala anha would have. She has been away from her land and been away from her family and been away from her community and her home for 13 years. In the process, she sacrificed her livelihood, lost her husband, had a baby, and now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has honored her with marriage to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so they arrive in Medina at the end of the month of Safar, or right in the beginning of Rabi' al-Awwal, 7 years after Hijrah, and she meets the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam once again, but this time not only as a Muslim, but also as his wife. And as she made her way to Medina to be the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she was also reunited with Salama radiallahu ta'ala anha, who she had a special relationship with. Salama and Habiba lived in Abyssinia together. They both left Mecca with their husbands to Abyssinia in similar circumstances. And both of them ended up marrying the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam through very different circumstances, but their journeys have a unique similarity, right? They both left with their husbands to Abyssinia, had children in Abyssinia, and were widowed in unique ways, and then both found their way to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, now married to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she had a special friendship with Salama radiallahu ta'ala anha. In fact, you find numerous narrations of them reminiscing on Abyssinia together and describing it to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So listen to this hadith, for example. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha narrating that Habiba and Salama were describing a church that they saw in Abyssinia to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's a pretty cool narration in and of itself, right? Aisha radiallahu anha, this is the narrator, and she's talking about this incident where Habiba and Salama are telling the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam what they witnessed in Abyssinia of a church. And these three women in this order, Aisha, then Salama, and Habiba, are the most of those who narrated on behalf of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay, so you have this narration that encompasses all three of them, and they described to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam a particular church in Abyssinia, and they said that it had in it tasawir, it had, you know, all sorts of pictures and tombs, and so they were shocked by the tombs and the pictures and the portrayals that they were seeing in that church. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that when a pious person amongst them passes away, that they build a place of worship on his grave, and then they decorate it with these types of pictures, and that these would be the worst of the people on Yawm al-Qiyamah in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is a hadith in Sahih Muslim that actually brings all three of them together. However, her response to marrying the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is different than Salama radiallahu anha in one very marked way. Salama radiallahu ta'ala anha, if you remember, asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or she told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that she was a jealous woman and that she was not used to the idea of being in a polygamous marriage, even if it was common at the time and common in their environment, certainly, and common amongst the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that she had not encountered or experienced what that was like. Habiba radiallahu ta'ala anha, on the other hand, this is an authentic narration, she says to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Ya Rasulullah, would you also marry my sister Azza?" Now, I mentioned last week, and I was actually wrong, that Habiba did not have any full siblings. She did have a few sisters that were full siblings, but her famous brothers, Yazid ibn Abi Sufyan and Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan, were half-brothers, so they had a different mother. So she says to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Would you marry my sister Azza?" Now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was obviously very surprised by that request, right? So he says to her, "Atuhibbina thalik? You know, is this a trick question? Would you like me to marry your sister as well?" The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not say, "Is this a trick question?" That's the sentiment that I may or may not be correct in conveying. All right, but the point is that do you want me to marry your sister? And she says to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she said, "Ya Rasulullah, I'm not your only wife, and I would hope that the person who would join me in this fortune would also be my sister." And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says that this is not lawful for me. This is not halal for me. And the reason why that's significant, by the way, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to marry more than what he allowed the other Muslims. And there was a wisdom behind every one of those marriages, right? None of them or all of them were widows and divorcees other than Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. And each one of them, there is a very detectable wisdom in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam marrying them, as we said in the case of Salama, also in the case of Habiba, in whose hearts were softened and what tribes were brought together. That is something that you find in each one of the marriages of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, some sort of hikmah that you see there. So the assumption that's being made here is that, you know, perhaps some of the other rules of marriage do not apply to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? So for example, being married to sisters is haram in Islam. It's, you know, narrated in some of the biblical books about other prophets that married sisters, but that's not something that is confirmed or outright rejected, but it certainly is not allowed in Islam. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, that's not allowed for me. And she said, I then said to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but we had discussed that maybe you would marry Durra bint Abi Salama, Durra, the daughter of Salama and Abu Salama. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, you mean the daughter of Abu Salama? So she said, yes. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, first of all, she's my stepdaughter. So even if she were not a stepdaughter of mine, she would not be halal for me, because remember, Abu Salama is my brother through feeding, right? That they were both nursed by Thuwaiba. So just like, you know, she wouldn't be halal for me for that reason, she would not be halal for me for this reason as well. So the Prophet ﷺ said, so don't offer me your daughters and your sisters, right? This is, in my opinion, subhanAllah, you know, if you take a step back, and obviously there are all sort of societal circumstances and things to consider, and, you know, family dynamics and culture. But one thing is for sure, that if the Prophet ﷺ was an opportunist, right? The Prophet ﷺ would discard all of these types of things. The fact that the Prophet ﷺ married who he married, right? And not a single woman who was not previously married other than Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, and waited this long, right, to get married into his 50s when polygamy was the norm at the time, really is actually a proof of his prophethood, right? It's a proof that he only acted upon divine instruction. And that's actually something to admire, because if the Prophet ﷺ was changing rules at sway, then he would have done so here. So this is one of those narrations where you find a very different interaction between Habiba and the Prophet ﷺ than you find from Salama radiallahu ta'ala anha and the Prophet ﷺ. May Allah be pleased with all of our mothers. Allahumma ameen. Now, when she came into Medina, as we said, this is after Hudaybiyah, and there's a time of peace. As we know, the Meccans broke the Treaty of Hudaybiyah. Now, when they broke the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, at that point, the Muslims were a lot stronger than when Hudaybiyah was actually drawn up, right? Because Islam thrives in peace. Islam thrives when the da'wah is able to move forward unhindered. The Prophet ﷺ's community had grown exponentially in this time of peace. And the Meccans were the ones who violated the treaty. And they knew that that was not a good move for them, that they were going to be in deep trouble, because the Prophet ﷺ had more members to his community now, right? They were not in a vulnerable situation the way that they were before. So once the Meccans broke Hudaybiyah, Abu Sufyan panicked. Remember, Abu Sufyan is the chief antagonist of the Prophet ﷺ at this point. And he panics because of the broken treaty. So he comes to Medina to reaffirm the treaty and to say to the Prophet ﷺ, we still have terms, and let's not let this one incident do away with the Treaty of Hudaybiyah. So he goes to the Prophet ﷺ in Medina. What does the Prophet ﷺ do? The Prophet ﷺ gets up and he leaves. He goes to Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu gets up and he walks away from him. Abu Sufyan goes to Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he's lucky that Umar did not punch him, right, or hurt him. You know, Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu ignores him, walks away from him. He even tries with Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha. Fatima, who had witnessed the cruelty that was used against her father, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, while Abu Sufyan was on the sidelines laughing and knew everything that had taken place in Mecca and went through that pain. But Abu Sufyan knew that Fatima had a way to the Prophet ﷺ's heart. So he tried with Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha. That also did not work. So after trying speaking to the Prophet ﷺ, and then Abu Bakr, and then Umar, and trying Fatima. And there are some other narrations that mention some other companions, right? After going around trying to find a way to affirm the treaty so that the Meccans do not find themselves in a bad space, he then goes to Habiba radiallahu ta'ala anha, his own daughter, and he has not seen her for years. He enters into the house of Habiba and realizes that the house of Habiba is the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And as he enters into her home, she was sitting on her bed. And remember that the bed of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a simple palm mattress. It was nothing fancy. It would leave marks on the back of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he had a singular blanket. So she's sitting on the bed. They would use it as a couch during the day, and they would use it as a bed at night. That's how simple the life, the hujurat, the chambers of the Prophet ﷺ were. So Abu Sufyan enters in. Habiba is there. She quickly folds up the mattress and she sits on the floor. And that was a very curious action from Habiba in front of her father. Because what was expected is that her father would walk in and her father would sit next to her on the bed. So Abu Sufyan looks at that and he says to her, Ya bunayyati, araghibti bihad al-firashi anni aw bi anhu? Am I too good for the bed or is the bed too good for me? Is the mattress too good for me or am I too good for the mattress? You know, what is this action that you just took? And so she actually affirms that, no, actually, this is the bed of the Prophet ﷺ and the bed is too good for you. You're not worthy of sitting on the same space that the Prophet ﷺ sits, right? So, you know, she actually does not allow for Abu Sufyan to sit on the bed of the Prophet ﷺ next to her. And this is where Abu Sufyan really finds that the doors are closing in his face and he's not able to make way with the Prophet ﷺ. And the Prophet ﷺ makes his way towards Fatih Mecca, towards the conquest of Mecca. But what does the Prophet ﷺ do when he gets to Mecca? The Prophet ﷺ shows them an unparalleled level of mercy and generosity, one that they had never given to the Prophet ﷺ. They had never given the Prophet ﷺ a portion of that when he was at their mercy. When the Prophet ﷺ was making his way towards Fatih Mecca, that is when Abu Sufyan embraced Islam. And that is when, of course, a lot of people embraced Islam. And the Prophet ﷺ gave amnesty to all of his enemies, all of those, except for a few that the Prophet ﷺ had named that posed an active danger to the community. The Prophet ﷺ gave a general amnesty to the population of Mecca, despite all that they had done to the Prophet ﷺ. And the Prophet ﷺ makes his way towards Mecca. When Abu Sufyan accepted Islam, and Muawiyah accepted Islam, and Yazid ibn Abi Sufyan accepted Islam. You know, it's narrated that Habiba's longest two sajdas were the day that Abu Sufyan accepted Islam and then Muawiyah accepted Islam. And that she, of course, loved her family and that this was something that was natural for these people, even if they had the disputes and they had the persecution that they suffered. They wanted their family members to change. They wanted them to embrace Islam. They wanted them to repent from all of the horrible things that they had done. And Habiba is no different with her father and with her brother. And so there's actually a narration where she's making dua. The Prophet ﷺ enters upon her making dua. And she's saying, Allahumma amti'ni bi zawji Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa bi abi abi Sufyan. Wabi akhi Muawiyah. So, oh Allah, allow me to accompany she's basically asking for a long life alongside the Prophet ﷺ and Abu Sufyan and her brother Muawiyah to derive the pleasure of the companionship of the Prophet ﷺ and Abu Sufyan and her brother Muawiyah. And the Prophet ﷺ said to her, you have asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about a period of life that is already set and the length of days that are already allotted and the sustenances which have already been fixed. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not do anything earlier than its due time, nor would He delay anything beyond its due time. And had you asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect you from azab al-qabr and azab al-nar, then that would have been better for you as well. And it would have been good for you and better for you also. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was encouraging her instead to make dua for the akhirah in regards to the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam and Muawiyah and Abu Sufyan. Now, this is another layer into the first, right? Abu Sufyan is one of the last to embrace Islam. And there are certainly many people that embraced Islam at the very last moment in Fatah Mecca, in the conquest of Mecca. And there's a narration that from Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, that the Muslims did not like Abu Sufyan. They didn't respect him. They didn't want to sit with him. They had a lot of pent up anger. And you might remember, for example, when we talked about Bilal and Khabbab and Suhaib, and they passed by Abu Sufyan on the day of Fatah Mecca, and they said that the swords of Allah did not reach the throats of the enemies of Allah. They were not happy, right? This was a man that they fought for 2 decades. And it was hard for them to accept suddenly that he would be amongst them. And this is natural. And so this gives us a way to actually deal with some of the wisdom and the compassion of the Prophet ﷺ in a different way, right? In a way that's instructive, but in a way that also shows that the companions had a hard time dealing with this. Remember, when Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu censored Bilal and Khabbab and Suhaib on the day of Fatah Mecca radiallahu anhum ajma'een, the Prophet ﷺ sided with who? He said that you may have made them angry, O Abu Bakr, and if you did, then you would have made Allah angry, okay? Not that Abu Bakr was wrong in saying that that's not something that should be said, but that, look, their experience was very different than the experience of Abu Bakr. These people were tortured by these elites of Quraysh, and they met them in battle, and they had their family members killed by them. They had a very different experience. So there's a layer of that, a natural layer of resentment. It was hard. It's not going to be easy. There has to be a period where the tensions are going to ease a bit. So Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he says that the Muslims didn't look to Abu Sufyan with any respect, nor did they sit in his company. And Abu Sufyan asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam 3 things. He said, Ya Rasulullah, confer upon me 3 things. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he responded to all 3. He said that I have the best and most beautiful daughter in Habiba. So marry her. The Prophet ﷺ said, okay, yes. Now, of course, the Prophet ﷺ is already married to her. So one way to look at this is simply affirming once again that, look, you've already given me this favor in marrying my daughter. And remember, Abu Sufyan was happy, even as a non-Muslim, that the Prophet ﷺ married Habiba. Then he said, secondly, he asked Muawiyah, he said, accept Muawiyah to serve, تَجْعَلَهُ كَاتِبًا بَيْنَ يَدَيْكَ, that you would allow him to be a scribe in your presence. So the Prophet ﷺ said, yes. Then he said, and allow me to be a commander in the army so that I can fight against the disbelievers the same way that I used to fight against the Muslims. And the Prophet ﷺ said, yes. Abu Zumail, who witnessed this, he said that had he not asked the Prophet ﷺ for these things, then the Prophet ﷺ would not have conferred them upon him. But it was the habit of the Prophet ﷺ to respond to people's requests, right? So this was the good khuluq, the good character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in responding to the people's requests. And you look at this and subhanAllah, there's more to this, right? When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam entered into Mecca, wasn't it Al-Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ya Rasulullah, as you enter into Mecca, make sure that you Abu Sufyan is a proud man, give him his recognition if you can. So, they should be grateful if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam does not kill them for all that they've done to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to the others. But what does the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam do when he comes into Mecca and he says that the people are safe? He says what? Man dakhala dar Abi Sufyan, whoever enters into the home of Abu Sufyan, fahuwa aman, then he is safe. He gave Abu Sufyan a place, right? Recognized his leadership in what he was doing in conquest of Mecca. This was not to crush the people now. This was to actually crush the idols and what they represented, right? This was not the ego of the Prophet ﷺ. This was the mission and the cause to which he belonged. And this is such a remarkable incident, right? That the Prophet ﷺ gave the request of Al-Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu to respect Abu Sufyan, to mention him by name. And he gave the respect to Abu Sufyan when Abu Sufyan asked the Prophet ﷺ those 3 questions. And I want to reflect on this for a moment. The Prophet ﷺ had a way with forgiveness, and he had a way of moving forward and looking to the possibility of these people, the potential of these people after all the horrible things that they had done. He had that heart with Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He had that heart with people early on that were enemies and people that later on embraced Islam. He had that heart with Khalid radiallahu ta'ala anhu, right? Amr ibn al-As. And who benefited as a result of that? The community moved forward as a result of that, right? These people brought tremendous contributions to Islam as a result of the Prophet ﷺ's forgiveness and his way forward with them, his forbearance towards them, his lenience towards them. The lenience to Ikrimah. Ikrimah, who was also one of the enemies of the Prophet ﷺ, who, you know, the Prophet ﷺ had initially named him as someone to be targeted, right? But Ikrimah repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he came and he became a part of the community of the Prophet ﷺ. And once you were a once you were part of the community of the Prophet ﷺ, you were going to be treated like a part of the community. So what does the Prophet ﷺ say? He says, don't taunt Ikrimah by mentioning his father Abu Jahl. Don't mention Abu Jahl to him. Subhanallah, Abu Jahl, the Fir'aun of this ummah, who tortured the Prophet ﷺ the way that he tortured him, who inflicted all sorts of psychological and emotional torture on the Prophet ﷺ, and Rasulullah ﷺ says, don't hurt his son by mentioning his name. What ends up as a result of that? Ikrimah dies a shaheed, right? In such a noble way, becomes such a noble companion of the Prophet ﷺ, and dies as a martyr in Islam. Abu Sufyan, his wife ordered Hamza radiallahu anhu's liver cut and chewed, right? The Prophet ﷺ accepted the repentance of Abu Sufyan and Hind herself. That's a hard thing for anyone to do. So it's not like the Prophet ﷺ was forgiving people that did him no harm, but did harm to other members of the community. These were people that caused him immense pain. But the Prophet ﷺ had a way with forgiveness and encompassing them and moving forward in a way that he could truly bring about reconciliation within the community. But the beautiful perfection of the Prophet ﷺ is what? Did the Prophet ﷺ tell Abu Sufyan to get up on the Kaaba and call adhan? No. The Prophet ﷺ put Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu on top of the Kaaba to call adhan. So the Prophet ﷺ did not remove Bilal or replace him, but he also didn't disgrace Abu Sufyan. Remember that these people's main complaint, they wouldn't even sit with the Prophet ﷺ in the presence of the mustada'afin, of the weak and the oppressed. The Prophet ﷺ still kept them in the highest of positions, still continued to honor them, still showed loyalty to them. So this was the beautiful, you know, example of the Prophet ﷺ, which is not an easy example to follow, not as an individual nor as a community, of encompassing and always keeping his eye towards growth and to the benefit of the deen and the benefit of the community, and being able to fit things so perfectly. So he would accept them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but he would not overlap, or he would not put them above those that Islam was built on their backs. هَلْ تُرْزَقُونَ وَتُنْصَرُونَ إِلَّا بِضُعَفَائِكُمْ. Are you given victory or the aid of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except by the way that you treat your most vulnerable, except by the way that you treat the oppressed? So this is a very powerful example of that. And subhanAllah, Abu Sufyan goes on to fight as a commander amongst the Muslims, and he dies in battle. Who would have thought, right? The man who was persecuting them and fighting against them dies in battle in that regard. And Muawiyah, of course, radiallahu anhu, goes on to play an immense role, right, in the community and things of that sort. So she lived to see, Habiba radiallahu ta'ala anha, lived to see her brother rise to power. And getting back to Habiba, one of the things that we learned from Habiba is that she avoided politics and she avoided privilege. She did not want to be privileged in the time when the Umayyad dynasty was was flourishing before her eyes. She did not want any type of privilege. She did not want any power. She avoided the fitan. She avoided the tribulations, the trials and tribulations of the time. And she continued to dedicate her life to worship, to hadith, to teaching Islam. And of course, rose to be the third in rank amongst the female narrators of hadith, as we mentioned. So she teaches us in that regard as well. And let's talk about her legacy for a bit in that regard. Habiba radiallahu ta'ala anha would narrate 65 ahadith, 10 of which are in Bukhari, 8 of which are in Sahih Muslim. And some of the most important concepts of Islam are taken from her ahadith. For one, as we said, Muawiyah and Ambasa would narrate from her. Her brothers would narrate from her. as did her daughter Habiba. So the one daughter Habiba actually married Dawood ibn Urwa ibn Mas'ud, the famous Urwa ibn Mas'ud, who was the chief negotiator of Quraysh, or one of the chief negotiators of Quraysh in Hudaybiyah. Dawood ibn Urwa ibn Mas'ud marries her daughter Habiba. All of them narrate hadith from her. One of her primary students becomes Zainab bint Salama, right? Bint Abi Salama, who we spoke about in great detail. Urwa ibn Zubayr also learned from her and narrated from her, radiallahu ta'ala anha. So again, an important look at the seerah in Abyssinia, an important look at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam through her eyes. And when I say there are some important concepts and narrations, I want to actually go through those, inshallah ta'ala. But before that, I get to those actually, inshallah, let me mention two incidents which I think are very important. One of them is when Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu was under siege. As we said, Habiba avoided the fitan. She didn't take part in the fitna. And when the people of fitna placed Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu under siege, Habiba radiallahu ta'ala anha, she had come on a mule and she hid water under her garments, because remember, they forbade Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu from being able to even drink water. The one who purchased the wells for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the one who expanded the masjid, the one who did all of these acts of kindness, and he was forbidden from benefiting from the very endowments that he set up, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So there was an understanding even amongst the people of fitna that the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam were to be treated differently. And Habiba wanted to use her privilege in that regard to help Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So Habiba radiallahu anha is riding a mule on her way to Uthman radiallahu anhu, and the people of fitna move aside. But then one young man stands up and says to her, "What are you doing?" in front of her. So one, and this shows you the hardening of the heart of the Khawarij, the making of the Khawarij. These people would read Quran, they would quote verses, but they don't even have the decency to respect the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So a young man stands in front of Habiba and says, "What do you want?" And Habiba is stunned that this young man has the nerve to do that. And then after that, he actually lifts her garment and he takes the water and he throws it to the ground, which was another stunning thing. I mean, imagine the punishment of this young man that would lift the garment of the wife of the Prophet ﷺ in front of the people and take the water vessel and break it. Not only that, and this is very nasty, he cut the rope of the mule, the reins of the mule that Habiba was riding. So the mule went wild and Habiba fell off of the mule in front of everyone. The wife of the Prophet ﷺ, the mother of the believers. And these people, these young men, who are the blueprints for all the extremist, or the Khawarij likes that come after them, is not making a connection, right? I mean, subhanAllah, these people are holding under siege Uthman radiallahu anhu, married two daughters of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and now insulting the mother of the believers, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in such a horrific manner, in front of all the people, embarrassing her, this young man who had the nerve to do that. And that was actually the incident that made Uthman radiallahu anhu order that all the Ummahat al-Mu'mineen go to Mecca. So before his assassination, Uthman radiallahu anhu sent all of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to Mecca to avoid, because he didn't want them to be harmed. So this shows you the nobility of Habiba and subhanAllah, a very unfortunate incident that took place with her. We also see at the time of her death, and this is a beautiful narration, unlike the one that we just recounted, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she narrates the death of Habiba, and Habiba lived for a very long time, shunning politics, shunning this, the civil wars and shunning all of these things. And she called for Aisha and she said to Aisha radiallahu anha, as she was dying, she said, "Listen, قَدْ كَانَ يَكُونُ بَيْنَنَا مَا يَكُونُ بَيْنَ الضَّرَائِرِ فَغَفَرَ اللَّهُ لِي وَلَكِ مَا كَانَ مِنْ ذَلِكَ." She said, "Listen, there used to occur from us or between us the types of things that are expected, right? In our situation. We used to argue sometimes. Sometimes we got into it. These were things that were expected." And she said, "So may Allah forgive me and you for all of those things." So she's asking for forgiveness. May Allah forgive me and you for all of those things. So Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she responded to Habiba. She said, "Ghafarallahu laki dhalika kullu wa halalaki min dhalik." She said, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive you for all of those things and release you from any type of accountability for that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala release you from anything of that. Of course, Habiba is a dying woman. She's seeking forgiveness because that's what we're supposed to do as Muslims, right? As believers. And she doesn't want to be held accountable in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She wants to bury any type of arguments or any type of hatchet. And Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha responded and said, of course you're forgiven and may Allah release you from any type of accountability in that regard. So Habiba, she smiled and she said, you've made me happy. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make you happy. And Aisha radiallahu anha says, she then called, arsalat ila Salama. She called for Salama, faqalat laha mithla dhalik. And they had a similar conversation. So subhanAllah, beautiful form of seeking forgiveness at the end of her life between her and Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, and then Salama radiallahu anha, the three most prominent female narrators of hadith and some of the greatest scholars of this deen. And of course, all three of them are our mothers, our ummahat al-mu'mineen. And I want to end, inshallah ta'ala, with this legacy of hers, which I think is a very significant one. One of the most famous hadith practices in Islam is narrated by Habiba radiallahu ta'ala anhu. عنها, and that is when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man salla 12 raka'a fi yawmin wa layla bunya lahu bihinna baytun fil jannah." That whoever prays in a day or a night 12 raka'as, Allah will build them a house in paradise. Habiba is the narrator of that hadith. So obviously the practice of praying 12 rak'ahs, the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, just like with all of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we get a dimension. But Habiba is the narrator of that hadith. But the way she narrates the hadith is very beautiful. When she narrated the hadith, قالت Habiba, Habiba says, فَمَا تَرَكْتُهُنَّ مُنْذُ سَمِعْتُهُنَّ مِنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. I never left off those 12 rak'ahs since I heard them from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وَقَالَ عَنْبَسَ, and عَنْبَسَ says, فَمَا تَرَكْتُهُنَّ مُنْذُ سَمِعْتُهُنَّ مِنْ أُمِّ حَبِيبَ. عَنْبَسَ says, and I never left off those 12 rak'ahs since I heard them from Habiba. And then Amr ibn Aws says, مَا تَرَكْتُهُنَّ مُنْذُ سَمِعْتُهُنَّ مِنْ عَنْبَسَ. I never left those 12 rak'ahs since I heard them from عَنْبَسَ. وَقَالَ النُّعْمَانُ ibn Salim, مَا تَرَكْتُهُنَّ مُنْذُ سَمِعْتُهُنَّ مِنْ عَمْرِ ibn Aws. He said, I never left off those 12 rak'ahs from the day that I heard it from Amr ibn Aws. So subhanAllah, this hadith in Sahih Muslim is so beautiful because it shows you that this was not just narrating words to these people. Every one of the people, starting from Habiba to every single person in the chain of narrators, is affirming that, you know what? I didn't just hear that these 12 rak'ahs get you a place in Jannah. I made sure that I always pray 12 rak'ahs in the day or in the night of sunnah. So that beautiful sunnah that we have, of course, most commonly carried out with the 2 rak'ahs before Fajr, 4 before Dhuhr, 2 after Dhuhr, 2 after Maghrib, and 2 after Isha, would equal 12 rak'ahs. That is from Habiba radiallahu ta'ala anha. We also see from Habiba radiallahu anha that the Prophet ﷺ says, whoever performs 4 rak'ahs before Dhuhr and 4 after Dhuhr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will harramahu Allah ala nar, Allah will forbid that person from the fire. Another hadith where the Prophet ﷺ said, and this is narrated by Habiba, her brother Anbasa ibn Abi Sufyan narrates from her that there is no believing slave who prays 4 rak'ahs after dhuhr that whose face will ever be touched by the fire. And this is a beautiful hadith that we find. It's also an authentic one in Sunan Nasa'i. So all of the, you know, the narrations in that genre, if you will, of the established practice of the Prophet ﷺ, even if it was not something that the Prophet ﷺ would always do, but to pray 4 rak'ahs before dhuhr and 4 after, is also through Habiba radiallahu ta'ala anha, with the reward being narrated as well. We also see some of the narrations of the Hajj of the Prophet ﷺ, as she was blessed to accompany the Prophet ﷺ on his Hajj, narrated there. Some of the narrations regarding women's issues, similar to Salama, though not in the same quantity. And obviously, as we said, the prohibition of the marriage of sisters and the prohibition of the marriage through Durra bint Salama. These are all things that we get through the lens of Habiba radiallahu ta'ala anha. But more than that, every single time a person hears, has heard the prayer of the sunan of dhuhr and does so, or the sunan of 12 and does so, acting upon her advice and her practice and her narration, we pray that she has a share of that and so much more in giving us that legacy that window into the life in Abyssinia of the companions, and of course the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah be pleased with her. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala join us with our mothers, with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, with the companions, with the righteous, with the martyrs, and the highest level of Jannat al-Firdaus. Allahumma ameen. Insha'Allah ta'ala, I will see you in a month, insha'Allah ta'ala, for the first. But as I said, we'll have other things along the way. Jazakumullahu khairan. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.